Welcome to this session of Thrythlind's One-Shot Adventures. I am the Game Master, Luke, also known as Thrythlind, and I will be running this session. Over the years, I have collected a large number of different role-playing games, many of which I have never gotten a chance to play, and I am still collecting now. So I have decided to take up doing these One-Shot Adventures as a way to try out some of these different systems and see how they work. Some of these systems will be very well known, possibly even popular. Number of them will be obscure and independent offerings. I hope you enjoy all of them equally, and I hope that they all end up performing well. And thank you for joining us. Have a good listen. Okay, so this is the first session of these one-shot games I want to start running. The first game we're going to be looking at is called Kuro. It is a game by Cubicle 7 Entertainment Limited. It's basically Japanese 4 plus cyberpunk type setting. The adventure we're going to be running to start with is based more on the horror parts than the cyberpunk parts. The cyberpunk parts don't make much of a dent in this one-shot. The included adventure in the actual book is very much more towards the cyberpunk than it is towards the horror, though it has a little bit of both. Now, unlike a lot of cyberpunk-type games, your characters are not necessarily already adventurers. The example characters in the book include typical on the edge of society types like the fixer, the cop, and the occultist, and the overclocker, who is sort of a computer genius. But then on the other hand, you have characters like the student, the media idol, and other such things like that. For this one shot, the characters that would have come with it include a biker girl, a yakuza, a detective, a model, a salaryman, and a schoolgirl. So the adventure in Kuro is supposed to come to the characters. And also kind of unusual for a role-playing game, but unless you've played Call of Cthulhu, but rather usual for anybody that's watched Japanese horror, the focus on Kuro is less on seeking out evil and facing it, and more on evils come to get you, and you have to survive it. So we were going to start with character creation, but I believe we already have, the people who are here already have two characters. I'll go ahead and, Doc, go ahead and introduce, to talk about the character you were coming up with. I believe you had a exchange student, a college student from out of Japan that got stranded here when the blockade came down.
Yep, that's correct. So yes, my character is John Blake. He is an exchange student in Japan who got caught up in the recent fiasco. And now the borders are closed and he can no longer leave the country. He is currently living homeless underneath a stairwell in the same building as the other character.
And Anne, go ahead and discuss your character.
I don't recall if we named my character. Did we?
No, we did not. So you're free to name your character as what you wish.
At any rate, my currently unnamed character was a translator attached to, I believe, an academic publication in Japan, which has kind of left her very underemployed, what with the blockade and demand for being able to translate foreign languages being way down in the setting. So she currently uses her more broad knowledge of the physical sciences and electrical engineering to do odd jobs and repairs for odd job level money, just to get by day to day in the drastically altered Japan that's come about following the blockade.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and go right into it. We'll sort of discuss the skills and such as they come into purpose. Okay, so that you know that what the way this adventure opens up is you guys are riding an old bus, which I will link a picture of in the default channel. And when I post this up to YouTube, it will be on the video. You're riding an old bus, possibly to get groceries or to look for an odd job or coming back from an odd job. It's up to you. There are six other people in the bus with you, not including the bus driver. It's been kind of driving for quite a while, and really kind of late at night. You wouldn't usually take a bus this old. It looks like it's even from the 20th century, much less the early 21st century. But it was rather late at night, and you wanted to be getting home, and you wanted to sit down and rest rather than, since you missed the train, the bus was the only option. Go ahead and describe where in the bus you're sitting or anything. Front, back, middle.
Haruka will be sitting just forward of the rear wheels of the bus, at the point where it typically raises the seating up to a higher level to pass over the rear axle. And she will be dozing lightly in her chair.
Okay. And where is John?
John will be sitting somewhere around the middle of the bus, thanking whatever benevolent god or one of the many sort of good luck charms he stuffed into a pocket from a Shinto shrine that he visited recently, that he managed to get enough money for this trip on the bus and didn't have to walk all the way home.
Right. Okay. So the other people on the bus, there is a middle-aged man who's got kind of a tired face, certainly looks like the standard salary man. There is a really just blindingly handsome guy. Has, you know, you can't believe that what you're looking at is natural, perfect hair, perfect teeth, latest fashions, all of that. And there is a rather tough guy in a white suit with white tie and black shirt, wearing shades that are probably Gantai's connected to his pod. Slight, little thin mustache, looks kind of like a shady character. There's another person who's in a somewhat cheaper suit, no tie, just kind of a turtleneck suit. Reasonable hair, slight, kind of a monocle type Gantai. Kind of looks, copish. And there is a biker girl, as well as a schoolgirl. Images being linked in the TeamSpeak default channel and will be included when I put this together on the media, on the movie maker. And those are the other six people in the bus. Okay, can I get a awareness roll from everybody? Or the both of you?
Awareness
is going to be your perception plus your awareness skill, which is based off of investigation. Your perception is the number of dice. Your skill is how much you add to it.
Okay. That's a total of 16. Rolled a 5 and a 6.
Rolled a 5 and a 6. You have the option of remember the 6, you re-roll. If you roll a 6, you re-roll it.
Right.
Do 6s always explode?
Yes, 6s always explode.
So I rolled another 5, which makes that 21.
Yep.
I rolled 22.
And, Doc, you do have the option of re-rolling a 5. I would not suggest it, because that's almost as high as you can get.
No, I'm not doing that. That would be silly.
Yeah. But you have the expertise. I'm bringing it up just because we're doing this for people new to the game, and we're new to the game. You do have the expertise gimmick on awareness, so you get to re-roll your lowest die.
Gotcha.
Okay. So both start to realize that the bus is sort of coming into an area where you don't recognize anything. It's kind of old. You don't see any lights on. You're not sure that any of the stores you're passing have been open for maybe since before the blockade.
I will slip my Gantai out of its case and look up my current location, see where we are relative to, like, where we are in the bus route. I'm not expecting to be off route yet.
Funnily enough, you slip on your Gantai and connect to your pod, and the pod doesn't seem to be able to connect to anything.
John looks out the window and sees if he can see any landmarks that he recognizes.
You're not seeing any stores you've come before. You're sort of off in the distance. You can kind of see the ruins of Kamata where you used to live. But right now, the things that are immediately around you, you're starting to come past what looks like a mini mart on the right and maybe a warehouse on the left. But you don't recognize any of them, and they don't look like they've been open for a while. But as you're starting to recognize that, and other people in the bus have started to realize that they're not anywhere recognizable either. But as you're starting to look out the window and see the mini mart pass by, the bus sort of sputters and comes to a clunky, clunky stop right smack dab in the middle of a crossroads with the mini mart on one corner and the warehouse on the other. It just feels like, you know, this old ancient bus is just giving up the ghost. And the driver is just sitting up there doing nothing at the moment.
Yeah, so John will get up and sort of start walking down the aisle, call out in Japanese, "Hey, driver, what's going on?"
You hear from the back one of the passengers saying, "Hey, yeah, what the hell just happened? Where the hell are we?" And as you get up, you're still getting no response from the driver. He's just sort of staring off out of the windshield.
John's starting to get worried that something's up with the driver, so he'll go up to the sort of still standing behind him. You know how there's a barrier behind the driver and you can sort of peek around. Is the cab open to the passenger side or is it sealed in?
It's open.
Yeah, so John will reach out and touch the guy's shoulder and say, "Hey buddy, are you okay?"
Any commentary from you, Anne, before I move on?
Haruka will have been a little slower to get up than John, but by now she'll probably be about halfway down the bus, hoping against hope that this is some sort of electrical fault that she can help repair and get everyone moving again.
Okay. As soon as you touch his shoulder, John, it's like his entire body just sort of collapses and dissolves away like liquid, going down into the seat and this kind of blackish, stagnant water until it sort of evaporates away and then there's nothing there.
John will jump back until his back is pressed against the opposite wall, wiping his hand on his jacket, going, "Jesus fucking Christ. What?
Seeing John's reaction, Haruka is going to dash forward to get a look at what the hell's happened.
From what you see, there is no driver there. There's no sign of the driver there. There's no clothes, no blood, no body. There's just nothing there.
Is the driver's side window or anything open?
No, it is closed.
So Haruka is going to look puzzled and turn to the... She'll look at John for a moment and then her gaze will move on to someone who's less obviously disturbed.
What?
On the driver's side of the bus, and she's going to ask if any of them have seen saw the driver get out and run past or something.
Hey, no, I didn't see anything that's coming from the model looking guy. What the hell has happened? You mean the driver's not up there?
He's gone.
He fucking well melted! What the fuck?
What the hell do you mean melted?
Just look!
She raises one sarcastic eyebrow as she just looks. Yes, no, I definitely see that he's not there.
And at this point, one of the passengers, the one that looks sort of like a detective, he probably actually fits in better than that, but I'm saying detective for ease of making it easy. Comes up to the front and say, "Wait, we didn't hear the door open. He didn't open the door. Somebody had to be driving the bus. So what the hell happened?"
I touched his shoulder and he melted. You saw me touch his shoulder. Someone must have seen me walk up and touch his shoulder, right?
Haruka's going to unobtrusively step a little further away from John's flailing hand. You know, not wanting to dissolve at all.
Right. Okay. Has anybody tried... Are the keys in the ignition? And you can kind of see that they are.
Yeah, John is going to check his hand and check, like, where he wiped his hand on his jacket for any evidence of the melting guy.
You don't see anything. Your hand looks dry to you, except for maybe getting a little sweaty.
Is there anything left of him in the seat? Like, is there wet patches and things?
There might be a somewhat wet patch, but it looks like it's just completely gone.
Well, he didn't climb out the window.
No, he just melted. Haruka's going to roll her eyes and turn to the other passengers. Can anyone drive a bus?
Is the window on the driver's side large enough for anyone to crawl through? It would take a contortionist for most buses I've seen.
No, they're very small. Let me look at the picture of the bus again. Yeah, they don't open that wide. They're pretty small. You don't think anybody could climb out.
Yeah, so John reaches over and sort of like tugs on the window handle and things, showing how small the opening is. And he's like, oh, yeah, I'm sure, you know, our bus driver was probably just the, the Japanese Harry Houdini.
Okay, just the biker girl kind of gives a exasperated, stands up into the aisle, get out of my way, let me get up there. Move, move! And she's kind of just pushing her way up to the front of the bus and sitting down. I can drive most things.
John will sort of step back and say, yeah, whatever you want. You know, holding his hands up like, yeah, I'm no threat.
Putting on her best, I'm trying to inject some humor and defuse the situation voice. Haruka will quip, just make sure not to touch her, okay? We don't want to dissolve a second driver.
Hey, if I had the power to dissolve people, I'd put it to better use than that.
Ha ha ha. And the biker girl is like starts reaching forward and twists the key in the ignition and say, this thing is like ancient, another last century. And starts twisting the key and just hearing the
Well, some things are old and some things are experienced, but I have a feeling this bus is just old.
Really gather what your sound effect you were trying to make there, Thrith, but it kind of sounds like the starter mode is not ticking over.
That's the most common sound effect I'm familiar with for a car not working, so limited experience.
The starter motor not working could very well be an electrical fault, so I'm going to go and have a look.
Yeah. John looks out around through the windows. What's the weather like outside?
It's very dreary. There's been scattered rain everywhere all night. I mean, right now it looks fairly okay, but, you know, there's puddles, like, everywhere.
So, yeah, John notices that we're stopped right in the middle of the crossroads, and he says, hey, maybe someone should pop over to their cafe and, you know, call the police or something.
You get a kind of a sarcastic snicker from one of the passengers, the one guy in the white suit. Yeah, we need the police to get here. That's exactly what we need.
Well, I'm just saying we're right in the middle of the crossroads here. You know, someone could come barreling down the road and hit us.
Haruka giggles behind one hand and pats John on the shoulder. It sounds like you've totally volunteered to head over to the cafe and play with their obviously disconnected phone for 5 minutes. Off you go. Like, this area is really uninhabited, right?
This one area has been uninhabited for at least months. There's overgrowth. There aren't any signs of any recent garbage. it's a dead area. It looks frankly abandoned. It looks like nature is trying to recover it.
John
well,
Smalls.
I'll tell you what, though, if you can find any food that hasn't gone off in the last couple of months, definitely bring that back. This could take a while.
John smiles at Haruka and says, "Yeah, I'll go do that while you try and restore this decrepit freaking bus."
Okay. And the biker kind of points at you, shut your mouth, let the women here settle the bus, since we're apparently the only ones that know how to do anything with machines. Freaking useless gaijin.
Hey, I resemble that remark.
Yeah. Go ahead and give me a roll on your electrical domestic systems. And you can tell from the way she's talking, and nobody's introduced themselves to each other yet, the way she's talking to the biker definitely knows her way around mechanics.
So this is intelligence domestic systems?
I would say so, yes.
Oh yeah, no, that's right. And then I reroll the sixes as well.
Our dice are on fire.
So accuracy is the one that adds 4 if you're... Is accuracy plus 4 if you succeed, or is it just a general plus 2?
It's a plus 4 if you succeed. Focus is a general plus 2.
Okay, so if I succeeded, that's 34.
Ooh. For reference, give me a moment to find the right PDF. For reference, a 32 is considered impossible. So you get a 34 on your dice. I'll go ahead and roll for Rin real quick here. Yeah, Rin is kind of stumped. She did not roll well. But you can pretty reasonably tell, more than reasonably tell, your character can pretty easily tell that the bus is dead. It needs some replacement parts. You're, in fact, fairly, I'm going to go ahead and say that it looks like a lot of the mechanical aspects of it need replacing as well. But kind of suspicious, because it looks like it should have been, some of this stuff has been dead for maybe months. You're not really sure why it was working at all.
God, it's a miracle we got this far. What time of day is it?
It is late at, it is about 10 p.m., 10:30 p.m.
In that case, I'll call back into the bus. Yeah, there is no way we're moving this bus without a new bus.
Well, if you can find the replacement parts, there is a workshop on one corner that might have them.
I don't know. From your description, it sounded rather like there was more than just a few replacement parts.
It is reasonable to assume that if you had the parts, you could get this bus running without major issue. It's just if you have the parts and you're in an abandoned area.
Should look back in. So it kind of looks like a miracle that the bus got us this far. We may have to get some of you big hunky boys to come and lift things for us. We'll have to raid this workshop and hope that they've got enough spare bits to kludge this together and let us get moving.
Did I end up heading over to the cafe or not?
You are heading over to the cafe, and I'm going to deal with that next. As you go look over at the cafe is dark and dilapidated. The interior can be seen through the large, grimy front windows. The door does open quite easily into a large area of molded plastic tables and cafes, and the area is served by a long counter with a till and stands for cakes and desserts. Behind the counter is a large kitchen area dominated by a large steel table surrounded by several cupboards. And you can't see much. You can see kind of old kitchen pans hanging from hooks above the table from where you are from the entrance. And there are several drawers.
Damn. Looks like a nice place. Just clean up a bit. Use some cats.
Everybody could hello? Use some cats.
Hello, is channel. Hello, is anyone there? Our bus broke down. Sorry, I'm just... Anyone squatting? Just basically calling out to see if anyone's around or answers before I intrude.
You just hear kind of dripping of water from deeper in. Here's the cafe area. And we have another player that's going to be joining us, and he's going to take over for the biker girl.
Hello.
Good evening.
Mind turtle.
As you can see, my voice is very appropriate for a biker girl.
That shouldn't be a problem, I don't think.
Yeah, I was joking. I'm sorry. I was in class. Couldn't join you guys earlier, but the game sounded too well to just ignore it.
Okay, so a refresher on the situation. You have some of it in the background of the pregen I sent to you. The bus you were on, suddenly somebody realized that you're in an area that nobody recognized and looked abandoned and dilapidated. And then the bus just sort of came to a clanking stop, and the one gaijin from the other two players, the one gaijin claimed that the bus driver disintegrated. That's your situation. Ooh. And you and the electrician lady, one of the other ladies on the bus who's an electrician being played by Anne, went and checked out the motor, and your character kind of freaked out because it's way older than any machine that she's dealt with, and she doesn't immediately recognize all the parts. The other lady's kind of an electrician and recognized that unless you can get some parts, you're not going anywhere. So you call into the cafe and you don't hear anything, just sort of a drip of water from somewhere deeper further in, maybe where elements have gotten to the roof and caused it to break and have a drip somewhere in the cafe.
Okay, so John will take a step inside, look around on the counters, go into the kitchen area, see if he can see any... a phone, anything like that. Barring that, he will start searching around, see if he can find anything that might be useful.
Okay. Go ahead and give me a quick awareness roll.
That would be a 14.
A 14. As you're going by the wall behind the counter, you kind of notice a bunch of photographs, and several of them stand out to you as definitely being the bus driver.
Can I take one of the photos of the bus driver?
Yes. He is in a photograph with a girl in sort of a gothic Lolita look.
Huh.
She's in her teens or something.
Does it look like Shiori at all?
No, it does not look like Shiori. Roughly about the same age, maybe a little bit older.
Yeah, that... So John's thinking to himself, so this is totally a fucking coincidence. And starts feeling a bit more nervous about the whole situation.
It definitely is showing a sort of... It's saying, you know, Mako's 18th birthday celebration, so definitely a little bit older than Shiori, the girl in the back, the other schoolgirl.
Right. John's going to take one of the Shinto charms that he carries around out of his pocket and sort of tie it to his wrist.
Okay. And you can also make, if you want, an empathy, which you don't have empathy... But you can make a perception roll if you want.
Okay.
This is just a base perception roll, not an awareness roll.
So just 2d6 plus...
2d6 plus 0, plus 0 since you don't have empathy.
Right, okay.
If it didn't have a specific skill attached to it, you would have added 4 because twice your perception. But there's a specific skill for it.
Right. So that is a total of 6.
Okay. So you don't really notice... anything much at all. There is a spot at one point where there is a looks like there might be an extra shadow, but it probably just camera tricks.
Trick of the light.
Yep. Okay. So there is a fridge back in the back, and it is locked. And there's a series of cookers and sinks. All the drawers, most of the cutlery has been removed, but you are able to find one sharp kitchen knife, and there's some pans. As to the cupboards around the kitchen, the counter contains a few out-of-date ingredients. Very little of it will be useful. You're kind of just looking around, not really finding much at all.
Yeah, I'm going to totally score that sharp kitchen knife. That could be a couple of days' worth of meals if I can pawn it or something.
As you're turning around, however, you can kind of see this image of the girl from the photographs sort of standing right by the counter and gesturing towards a small bottle right there.
Is she transparent?
No, you don't look. She doesn't look transparent, but she's holding very, very still and just kind of looking at you with really sad, sad eyes.
So John sort of breath hisses out through his teeth and says,
And you get through, and she disappears.
Oh, fuck. After a moment of indecision, he looks at the bottle she was pointing at.
It's a bottle of salt. And we're going to go towards Iban, and we're going to go towards Anne's character and Rin with the bus. Okay, so you two have reasoned that a replacement parts are necessary. Okay.
Can you, for my benefit, give a quick rundown of the characters and who is where and all that?
Okay, so far there is 8 people here on the bus, including you. One is the Gaijin who went to the cafe to look for some food. He's the one that claims the driver just melted into nothing. No one else quite saw that. There is somebody you're supposed to meet here. There is also another 5 people. There's a schoolgirl. There is someone who is definitely a model of some sort. He looks way too handsome and too perfect and probably has had work done to be anything but a actual model. Then there's a salaryman. There's this lady you're working on the bus with who looks kind of like an academic. She's in good shape, though. She does some sort of exercise. Go ahead and give me a perception roll. Just roll your 2d6.
Okay, give me a second. So rolls are 2d6, or are they based on the characteristic?
The rolls are based on the characteristic. And I've noticed something here that I should have been more careful about. 4s count as 0, and 6s explode.
Okay, my perception is 2, so I guess I rolled 2 dice.
Yes.
I got a 4 and a 2.
So you got a total of 2.
Which I think is bad.
You got a total of 2, so because the 4 counts as 0. We need to remember that from now on the other die, on the die roll that everybody else is using, because I've seen a couple places where we've included 4 and forgot that.
4 doesn't count as 0 on exploded dice, three.
That's right. Okay.
For reference, Iban, it's Asian superstition. The number 4 is a homophone for the word for death, so 4 is normally a bad thing.
That's really unusual. Cool. Okay.
Well, it's no more unusual than 13. We're just used to 13.
I was talking about the fact that it's a homophone for death.
Oh,
it's
right.
Such a common word. I would have guessed like people who have changed it.
They actually have two different versions of the word for, and one of them does not sound like death. So yeah, they did that, but there's still the superstition.
Uh-huh. So same thing as left and sinister.
Right, so the last guy you have is a guy kind of in a cheap suit, looks like a professional of some sort. You've kind of written him off as not important, kind of like the salary man, but in some other job, not quite an office job. And I believe I already linked the map of the crossroads.
Yes. What does the other character look, the one that went into the cafe? Just so I can get a mental idea.
He's a Caucasian male. He's 20 something, fairly nondescript. He has brown hair. He's currently wearing a hoodie underneath a denim jacket over a fairly worn t-shirt. He looks homeless. He looks like he's been sleeping underneath a stairway for quite a long time. How long? It's been a few months since the Japan,
6 months,
basically. Yeah, so he's been sleeping under a stairway for the last 6 months and just getting by on his art and stuff like that.
Okay.
So, looking around, one of the guys that I'm going to go ahead and say is the cop kind of looks around. So, you need parts. There's the cafe. that looks like a mechanic shop. There's this other warehouse, and maybe there's starters, fuses, and the mini marts. He's kind of shrugging.
Well, let's go check the mechanic place.
Okay, is everybody going to go, or who is going to they're going to the workshop?
I think we can divide now. Well, a few of us can go to each place. I can go to the mechanic shop. The old lady can go to the warehouse, because she seems to know what things are, and I think she'll be able to find something useful.
How's that sound to you, Anne?
I can live with going to the mini-mart.
Okay. Mini-mart or warehouse?
The rest of the people who I guess are around and say any of you want to join and see if they can help us?
We should probably nominate some of the... I'm going to nominate Monocle Guy as my designated come with me and carry things. Do my bidding, since you're obviously not being useful for repairing stuff.
He kind of looks a little bit hesitant, and you kind of catch him glancing off towards the guy in the white suit, which is the guy you're wanting to meet, Ren. And after a moment he says, okay, fine, I can go with you to the mini-mart.
So the guy in the white suit goes with Anne, is the name?
Anne is her... Go ahead and introduce your character if you want, since we're getting to put a position where people knowing people's names is important. It's like perhaps somebody should suggest introducing names.
Yeah. My character's name's Haruka.
Okay.
For reference, Thrythlind, I thought you may have picked this up, what with living in Japan and all that, but yeah, no, they really wouldn't have exchanged names by now.
You're right. I'm sorry. Yeah, they would not have exchanged names.
Okay.
The guy with the monocle gown tie and the academic lady are going to go to the mini-mart. And I guess you're going to gesture for the guy in the, you're doing, and the guy in the white suit kind of shrugs and says, okay, I'll go make sure, cover her back. And we'll go with Rin. And the model kind of sort of goes back into the bus and says, okay, I'll stay here. And when you guys are done, just tell me. Because I've got places.
Sure, the bus doesn't go anywhere.
Right. And the schoolgirl looks very nervous. Is it okay if I just stay here as well?
If you want a babysit?
I'm 17. I don't need a babysitter.
If you want to babysit him...
Oh! And she gets this really bright blush over her face.
I'll wink at her.
Let's head up to the workshop first.
So, I'm working with the guy I looked at before, right?
Right. Yeah, white suit. You think he's the guy you're supposed to be meeting.
Well, as soon as we are out of sight, I'll be like, yo, what happened? You were supposed to meet me.
And he kind of glares at you and kind of glances over and very subtly just says, quiet. Don't be so obvious. We got a tail. I got a tail. Don't want him making a connection.
I'll know then. Start looking for the stuff then.
So the workshop, you can clearly see, looks like it has a repair bay quite large enough for the bus. So this bus probably usually ends up in the workshop. There's a garage area. It has two doors, but both are locked. And the larger main door is big enough to admit this single-decker bus. But it is really heavily warped, so you don't think it will open even if it is unlocked. There is a smaller door there, though. And outside is a rusty petrol pump.
So the only two doors are closed, right?
The only two doors are closed. One of them is so beaten up. The biggest one, the one for the bus, is so beaten up that it will never open, probably. Unless you just, destroy it. There's a smaller door that's more simple.
Okay. Does it look like I could open it?
You want to try to force it open?
Well, actually, I look at my contact and, point at the lock and say, can you get that open? Should I give it a try? He's a professional criminal.
he kind of goes up to the, he goes up to it and says, there's no real reason to be subtle about this, and just sort of kicks it open. And then sarcastically gestures for you to go inside as if you're some sort of lady.
We'll just walk in, I guess.
So there are two areas to the workshop, and I'll get you a map in a little bit here. There are two areas to the workshop. There's no partition between them. There's a set of stairs that leads up to a second floor. There is a large area that definitely functioned as a garage at one point, but it is mostly empty. There are definitely some parts for the bus around here. And it looks like it might take a while to find some useful ones. A lot of the ones you see right off the top of the bat are old and rusted.
What time of the day is it? Like, what's the weather like? Is it night? Is it day?
It's about 10:30 at night and intermittent drizzling. There are puddles everywhere.
Okay, do the lights work?
No, there is no power to this.
Okay, are we using like torches or something like that?
You can have your, you probably have a pod which can double as a light source. It's kind of like a future cell phone that doubles as a small computer, and those will probably have a light giving option.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah, you have a pod. And you're finding yourself in sort of a tool area. This is the smaller door that you pushed open is a tool store and tool storage and workbench area. There's an old wooden bench with a vise and a few manual tools. And you can find lots of pictures of some girl in her late teens dressed in gothic Lolita looks. The older versions, the older pictures of her, she's in gothic Lolita. The younger ones are more normal. Go ahead and give me a perception roll real quick. 2d6.
Say, six explode, right?
Six explodes.
That's 12.
You have a 12?
Six, three, and another three.
Yep, that's a 12. It's average. Okay, so you can kind of easily see that the older she gets, the less she smiles.
Hmm.
So right now, you're downstairs. There's lots of parts scattered around. There's a stairs going up as well. You can start to search through the parts, or you can go upstairs.
I'm guessing upstairs it's going to be the office or something. Maybe there is a record and we can look up what parts we need there. I'll say to the other guy and I'll go upstairs.
Okay, and I'll start looking for something that isn't rusty. Upstairs, there's a small living quarters. It looks like somebody, the girl and her father lived. There's a small kitchen and two rooms. The main room seems to have doubled as a living room and a bedroom for somebody. And it is definitely shows signs of a struggle. Doors are broken open. Most of the furniture is broken. You can actually find bloodstains still in places.
Are they fresh at all?
No, these are old bloodstains.
I think that by now this place is going to be giving me the creeps, so do I have the knife that it's in my character sheet?
Yes, you do.
Well, I'll, like, pull it out. I'll be a bit subtle about it because I don't know, I don't want to scare anyone I just bump into. And I'll start looking around the place.
Okay, the top floor is not all that large, so it doesn't take you much to look around. It is very sparse. There wasn't much here. And going into the next room, you do find a little bit more decoration here. This was obviously the girl's room. There are a few gothic posters around, and there are a few books and manga and some clothes in here. What immediately strikes your attention, however, is that on the mirror on the wall is written in black lipstick, "I didn't ask for you. Go away."
The Lolita girl in our bus doesn't look at all like the one in the pictures, does her?
No, the girl in the bus is a standard schoolgirl. She doesn't dress gothic Lolita.
Oh, okay.
Give me a quick awareness roll. That'd be perception plus awareness. Does she have awareness? She does not. So that's going to be just perception again.
That's a 9.
Okay, I'll give that to you. You do kind of notice also that the bed has been surrounded by what was a ring of salt. It's, you know, there's salt all over the floor around the bed.
Does it look like it's been, like, I don't know, blown by the wind or something like that, or has it been broken?
It looks like somebody deliberately scattered it around the bed and then over time, whatever reason they put it around the bed, over time there's just kind of gone out into this mess.
Oh god. Are there any nice clothes? Anything I would like for myself or the schoolgirl in the bus?
That's all kind of the gothic stuff, and it's been in the elements for months at the very least. It all looks like it's falling apart. You're going to stay up here?
I'm still looking for something that might serve as a office or some place where they would keep records. Also, anything else useful?
It's looking more and more like this upstairs is just for living quarters.
I'm just thinking like maybe there is a computer or something that might be valuable because it doesn't look like anyone lives here. So I'm not very...
Right,
I don't
okay.
really mind taking anything I see.
Okay, go ahead and give me a perception roll.
That's a one.
Four and a one. A four and a one, so that's a one. You don't really find anything all that useful in here.
Okay, I'll sheath the knife and go downstairs then.
Okay. As you're going downstairs, you kind of sort of notice a file folder that's on one of the workbenches. Not really sure what calls your attention to it. It's just sort of something that you notice as you come down the stairs.
And I'll open it.
And it appears to be a police report showing the photograph of the guy that you were supposed to be meeting about the deal. And showing a history of him acting as a police informant. And I will go switch over towards the mini-mart. Are you ready?
I am.
Okay. Looking at the mini-mart, the windows are very grimy. You can sort of barely see the inside through them. The mini-mart is not just locked, it is chained shut.
I don't suppose you can pick locks, can you? This is directed at my escort.
It's not a skill I've picked up along the way. Sorry.
That's fine. Can I make a map of the building looking for alternate entrances?
Yep. And as you go along towards the back, you find there is a hole in the wooden paneling around the side. You don't think that the monocle guy with you is small enough to get through, but you could get in if you really had to.
It's wooden paneling, right?
Yes, it is.
You reckon you can smash this wide enough to get in?
Yeah, I could try. Give me a moment. Let me through real quick. He doesn't have an athletic skill. Okay, so he manages... I went ahead and did it as a raw strength thing. He manages to get a 10. He's kind of beating around at the door, at the paneling there, and kind of manages to break off some bits, but doesn't look like he's getting much progress done on getting it wider.
In that case, I'll put on my best disappointed voice and... Really? That's your big, tough, manly man mode?
Hey, these things are tougher than they look.
I guess I'll shake my head disparagingly and slip into the hole.
Okay. So it's kind of divided into two parts. You immediately see that it's very much bare. It is very, very bare in here. Now, please roll me a perception roll, awareness.
Awareness is an investigation skill, isn't it?
Yes, it is. So you're going to do a plus two. And roll another six. And another. So that is a total of 18. Okay. You are about three quarters of the way through the hole and kind of looking around and starting to think about standing up when you hear a growling sound.
From inside or outside?
From inside. And you can kind of catch sight. You catch sight for a moment of eyes in the darkness, sort of reflective eyes.
In that case, I say, oh shit, oh shit, oh shit, get back out the hole backwards and turn to the monocle guy and say there's some sort of wild animal in there.
Okay. And we're going to pause there and go back to John. So, John, last we left you, you had been directed to a bottle of salt by a disappearing gothic Lolita.
Indeed. If nothing else happens, get out of there with haste, cautious haste, and get back to the bus to see what's going on there.
Are you going to take the salt?
Absolutely, and the knife.
Okay, so you come barreling out of cafe, or not barreling out, you come out of the cafe looking over your shoulder, very frightened, with kind of a frightened demeanor. as you start walking very quickly back to the bus, and you can immediately see that not everybody's there. At the very least, Haruku and Rin, Haruku's gone. The guy who is wearing the monocle's gone. The guy in the white suit is gone, and the biker girl is gone. All that's left is the model, who's kind of lounging in the bus, and the schoolgirl, who's sort of sitting on the at the bus doorway near the driver's seat, looking very nervous, left in different directions.
So, poke my head in the door and go to sort of nod at the model guy. Hey, where'd the other scarper off to?
They went to go get parts for the bus. And that's the girl answering. She kind of points, the teacher lady went over there towards the mini mart. And the other, with the guy with the monocle, Gantai, and the other two went over there towards that workshop, the garage thing over there.
Right. Neither of you seen, like, Gothic Lolita girl? He takes out the picture he took out at the cafe and sort of shows them, points to the girl.
The model kind of half looks up and says, no, she just looks like us. Kind of, you see those all the time. So that's, I haven't seen anybody like that. And the schoolgirl kind of, who's getting a closer look, kind of points toward the man in the picture with her, saying, hey, isn't that the bus driver?
John sort of nods and says, looks at the picture again and says, yeah, I think so. Look, something's going on here. He looks at the schoolgirl, says, so what's your name?
My name's Shiori.
Nice to meet you, Shiori. I'm John. Do you think you could sit up the front here, keep the door open, and just be ready to shut it, just in case, you know?
And she's kind of nodding very quickly at that point.
He pauses and takes one of the charms that he sort of collected out of his pocket and says, look here, I mean, I've got plenty of these. Why don't you take one?
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Good luck, you know. Can't hurt to have more good luck, right?
Right. Anywhere else you want to do with that?
Can I hear anything that might be happening in from the other two places?
At the moment, actually, suddenly at the moment, you do hear what sounds like loud barking coming from the direction of the mini-mart. Can I go ahead and get initiative rolls from all of you? That would be your reaction, which I have it listed here on your sheets as REA. It's 3 for John. It is 4 for Haruka, and it is 4 for Rin. So you'll roll that many d6, and you'll add that number, double that number. So Haruka will roll 4d6 plus 8, Rin will roll 4d6 plus 8, and then John will roll 3d6 plus 6.
And 4s count as 0?
4s count as 0.
Oh my god.
And 6s explode.
Yep.
Dog. All the hugs.
Iban, go ahead and roll your 4d6 where you are.
Can I get new dice? I rolled 2 4s and 3. So 3 in total with 2 4s.
You had 4 dice, though, because you have a 4 reaction.
I know.
So you rolled a total of 3?
Yeah.
Well, you're not alone. John rolled a total of 1.
39.
How many actions do you guys get? That VACT?
I get 1.
So all that awesome roll and you get 1 action.
Yeah, I also get 1.
Is that reaction speed?
Yeah, it's reaction speed. Yeah.
Okay. You are talking about actions now, no? Right? How many we get?
Right. So usually if you got two actions, you would go at whatever you rolled your initiative, then you would go at 10 later.
I only have one, too, so...
Well, the dogs didn't roll any better. And neither did Hiroshi, which would be the cop. Okay. So, Anne, you get to go first.
I'm going to leg it back to the boss and try and get inside and close the door.
Okay. And you have a move of 3.
Yeah. And I'm also going to be screaming, dogs, 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 dogs.
Okay, and I believe John had a 3. No. John had a 1, and Rin had a 3.
John had a 7. You said it's reaction dice plus twice your reaction?
Oh, you're right. John had a 7, and Rin had a 11. So, Rin, go ahead and your action.
Say again?
Your action. You get to go simultaneously with some of the wild dogs. 2 of the wild dogs.
Where I am, I don't see any, right? I just hear them.
You just hear barking, yes. Really loud, hostile barking.
And someone yelling, dogs, dogs, dogs.
Yes.
Is there any sort of, like, wrenches or some big stick or something like that? Anything I can see?
Yeah, you can go ahead and pick up a club if you want. That'd be definitely fine.
Well, first of all, I'll put the file I just found inside my jacket, like I'll hide it there. I'll pick up the club and go out running.
Okay, so you're going to do another move at 3. And now it's 2 of the dogs' turn, and the first 2 dogs come rushing out and attack Hiroshi, since he hasn't gotten his action yet.
I'm sorry, Monaco guy, your sacrifice will be remembered.
So glad we have red shirts.
And the first one gets a 22 against a defense of 11. So that is a margin of success of 11. So he takes 18 wounds from one of the dogs.
That's John, right?
That's Hiroshi. That's the cop, actually. You don't know he's a cop right now, but the cop. And 12 from the other. So he took 30 hits. Yeah, he's gone down. Unconscious. He's been taken down. He suffered 2 serious wounds. Immediately, he's just barreled down by the first 2 dogs. And coming up behind him, behind those 2 dogs, before John gets a roll, and your friend in the white suit isn't putting himself out at all. He's sort of just shrugging it off. It looks like 2 more dogs come out, and I'm going to just rule that that's pretty much the end of the cop. And it's John's turn.
I'd say John would see Hiroshi going down.
Yeah, you can kind of see him falling off, attacked by 4 dogs from around the corner.
And pretty much torn to pieces.
Yes. And Haruka's running from them.
Yes, yeah, so he'll hop into the bus and get ready to close the door behind Haruka.
Okay. This is when another dog comes out, looks to see that its fellow packmates are kind of taking care of the one police officer, and starts heading off after Haruka. And back to Haruka's turn.
I'm going to continue legging it and hopefully get close enough to the bus to leap in.
Okay. And Rin, your turn.
Can I, like, run straight and intercept the dog that is trying to attack Haruka?
I'll let you do that. Yeah, I'll let you do that.
Basically, I'm sprinting and... Right when the dog is going to leap for Haruka, I just smash it with the club.
Okay. Haruka, you're about... You got another 3 yards, meters, excuse me. So you're about... Next turn, you'll be able to get into the bus.
So do I roll?
You're doing a rush on the dog?
I guess so.
Okay, now...
Or would you translate that into rules? So.
Okay. There are 3 kinds of attacks. There is a normal attack, which would use your dexterity. There is a power attack, which would use your strength. And there is a fast attack, which would use your reflexes. The strength allows you to, the power attack allows you to make it harder to hit, but do more damage. And the reflexes, the fast one lets you make it easier to hit, but do less damage.
My stats are all the same, so I'd rather hit the dog and keep it out of Haruka's way.
Okay, so just a normal attack?
Yeah.
I'm going to call this your brawling, because unless you're using a weapon, I'm going to call this brawling. Are you shoulder
club?
Okay, are you going to use the club or are you going to use shoulder check it? Because your brawling stats are really high.
I see that. Well, I guess then I'll kick it.
Basically. Okay.
Or whatever you want, however you want to dress it. So I roll 2d6 and I add the 8.
Except for, you know where it says Gimiku and it says boost next to your character?
Yeah.
That means you roll an extra die.
Okay.
So you're on 3d6 plus 8.
That's 20 in total. I had an exploding 6.
You had an exploding 6, so you got 20 in total.
Yep. Do I hit?
Yes, you hit. You quite easily hit. You are able to go ahead and get it pushed well clear out of the way, and it is going to be knocked over prone for this time. The other dogs are engaged in their meal for the moment. And John, your turn.
What am I saying?
You just saw the biker babe kick the dog out of the way from behind Haruka. Haruka's running towards you.
Yeah, I'm standing ready and waiting at the door to close it behind people who run in, but I'll call out get in here. I don't know Rin's name yet, so sorry.
Right.
So I'll call out, get in here, quick.
Okay, and Haruka?
I get in there quick.
And Rin?
I'll check around if no one is going to be attacked like right now. There's no dog trying to bite me, I'll run too.
Right. No, the other four dogs are still eating the guy that went to go help Haruka.
In that case, I'll run. What happened with the other guy, the one that was with me?
He doesn't seem to follow you.
Well, I'll worry about him when I'm not about to be dinner.
Yeah, we'll find him eaten later.
Yes. Okay.
He's already in a workshop. He could just go somewhere and close the door.
I still reckon we'll find him eaten later, but never mind me.
Yeah.
Yes, so as soon as the biker bay gets through the door, slam the door shut behind him.
Give me a reflex roll. It's going to be your reflex in dice plus double your reflex. That's REF. So that would be 2d6 plus 4.
I don't want to talk about it.
Okay.
Can I re-roll one of those?
You have expertise in... No, you don't. This isn't the thing you have expertise in. But
oh, well.
So you're getting it closed, but it closes kind of into the dog. The front half of the dog managed to get in. It's scrabbling at the stairwell and trying to push its way through to come get at the lot of you that are in the door. It hasn't figured out that it's outnumbered now. You've got it trapped in the doorway.
Still so my turn, or...?
It is going to be Haruka's turn.
Okay.
The dog is growling and snapping and trying to push its way in.
Haruka might see a knife on my belt.
I think I might just get out of the way of people who are better suited for this. I'll duck slightly down the aisle of the bus and then haul myself up into one of the bag racks overhead.
Okay, give me an athletics roll.
Dex athletics?
Yes.
4.
Don't you have an athletics score? Oh, no, you don't, do you? Okay, so you don't manage to kind of incline to try to climb up into the cargo racks. You manage to knock over one of the few bags that's over there and drop some of the what looks like it's probably the schoolgirl stuff all over the top of the model. And it is Rin's turn. And looking out the window, you can see the other four dogs are getting finished and looking back towards where their fellow went.
And so he's blocking the door, right?
Right. So right now, yes.
Well, I have a club in hand and a dog that cannot move. I guess it's quite obvious. Course of action is to beat the crap out of it. Or yeah, I'll take a suggestion and kick it out.
Okay. You're a fan of old Frank Miller films, I guess. Okay, go ahead and roll your brawling again. 3d6 plus 8.
It's worse this time. It's only 19.
Okay.
Oh, well, no, you... because 4s are zeros. Oh, that sucks. Then it's only 11.
It's only 11? You do barely manage to hit it. Go ahead and give me 1d6. Plus, its defense is reduced because trapped indoor.
My d6 was a 1.
Give me a moment. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and ask you to do an opposed roll. Roll your strength. You hit it. I'm going to go ahead and have you oppose your strength versus its to see which one wins. Her strength is, I believe, a 2. So it's going to be 2d6 plus 4 versus its 2d6 plus 4.
I just rolled double sixes. I'm doing the victory dance right now.
Awesome. It did not roll double sixes.
Roll them again and then add my strength, right?
Yep. Actually, add double your strength. But
22.
22. Yeah, it goes flying out, skidding across with a minor case of road rash, and the door snaps closed. Thank you for listening to this session of Thrythlind's One-Shot Adventures. I hope you enjoyed listening to us play this game, and that it has encouraged you to try to give some of the more obscure and independent games that are on the market a little bit of a try. Following this message, there will be credits related to the specific company or game that was featured in today's session, as well as any visual media that were used to give a little bit more atmosphere to this, to the published session. Okay, so this is the Cubicle 7 webpage. I'm looking at their list of games. They have a Doctor Who card game, a Doctor Who role-playing game, a current Lord of the Rings role-playing game, something called Hobbit Tales, which is apparently a storytelling game, a Primeval role-playing game, which is a very good sci-fi, British sci-fi show, if you can catch it. I think it ran for about 5 seasons. It was pretty enjoyable. The Laundry, which is a humorous take on Call of Cthulhu. You might want to look into that. A steampunk role-playing game. A retro sci-fi role-playing game, kind of like the original versions of Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon with the rocket ships and the bubble-headed helmets and stuff like that. World War Cthulhu. Cthulhu Britannica. In the Warring States, which is apparently a French RPG originally, but has been brought over into English. It's set in the Warring States period of China. It apparently does involve a lot of the magic and the martial arts action. You Are Already a Hero, Become a Legend. And Yggdrasil, which is Viking sagas, including all the magic and the beasts and I think it includes the beast and all that. Anyway, it involves the Viking sagas. And the game that we were playing here, Kuro, which this says the year is 2048. The actual book says the year is 2046. And so these are some of their games. Kuro, at the very least, is, I believe, worth picking up. If I had a little bit of extra funds, I would probably try to pick up some of these others. But for now, all I have is the Kuro one. So please do take a look at this if you get a chance.